Session 11, there's only 12. Chapter 13, there's only 14. So we'll wrap up next week. And let me just say, you don't want to miss the last chapter. You know why? What happens in chapter 14? Jesus comes. So if you miss chapter 14, sorry, you're not going to make it. All right? I ought to send out an email and tell people that. Hope everybody has a good Thanksgiving tomorrow with your family, and I'm looking forward to that as well. And I have been working quite a bit on this next semester stuff, and I told a couple of the ladies I have finished 8 sessions. I locked myself away and been working on that. Wow, some incredible stuff when you really get deep into it. I am almost finished. I finished the book of Joel and one chapter in Amos, and have one chapter away from finishing Micah. And then we'll go to Malachi, and that'll outline what will be the 400-year study. So it's going to be called, it'll start middle of February, and it will show the prophecies of the last 400 years of Israel and Judah until all the prophecy ended, which ushered in 400 years of silence. And the silence was broken by the last prophet in the Old Testament. Here's your trivia question as we start, and you will get it wrong. John the Baptist. He's the last prophet. And he comes shouting, what? 400 years of silence. Not a word. And John the Baptist comes and says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." And here comes Jesus. And you know the rest of that story, I hope. So tonight, I'll pray and we'll start chapter 13. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this journey. We've traveled together through the book of Zechariah and the power of your word. So Lord, tonight, I just pray your blessing upon us. Give us eyes that see and ears that hear and hearts that can receive this. Because some of it is hard to receive, Lord. It's hard. But we believe you. We believe that the Bible is your word, and you have written it and protected it and sustained it through the generations by your great power, that we might know the one true God and Jesus Christ, who he sent to save the world. And it is in his name that I pray. Amen. As you read chapter 13, you can see how important it was that Israel was reestablished in 1948. Without Israel's reestablishment, I am amazed how anyone would read much of this and understand it. On that day, I want you to notice how many times you will hear that tonight. On that day. What day? There's a day coming. Something big is coming on that day. Zechariah 13, verse 1. On that day, a fountain will be opened for the dynasty of David and for the people of Jerusalem, a fountain to cleanse them from all their sins and impurity. Anybody remember the last king from the dynasty of David? It's not Zechariah. Sounds close to that. Zedekiah. He was killed somewhere around, I'm guessing, 586 B.C., and he was the last of the lineage of David to hold the king. He was king in the tribe of Judah. Been a long time since Judah's had a king. And Nebuchadnezzar put his eyes out, and the last thing that happened to him before he was blinded is he got to watch Nebuchadnezzar kill all of the lineage that would have followed him. The entire dynasty of David, he watched them die. Think about it. Nebuchadnezzar ended all of his sons. He killed them in front of the king, and then he put his eyes out so that the last thing he saw was the end of the dynasty of David. It's over. The kingdom of David ended. Or so they thought. There is a king from the lineage of David that will reign. Notice it says, on that day a fountain will be opened in the dynasty of David, number one, and number two, and for the people of Jerusalem, a fountain to cleanse them from all their sins and impurity. A fountain is an Old Testament symbol of cleansing. In this case, it is the result of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. What's the fountain? The Spirit of God is going to open and pour Himself out on the dynasty of David and the people of Jerusalem. So I want you to picture this Spirit as living water, and the well's going to open and He's going to spill it out. Remember the lady at the well? He said, if you only knew who you were talking to, you would ask me and I would give you living water. It would become in you a well springing up into eternal life. There is a Holy Spirit that's coming to Israel and to the dynasty of David. And what's the point? What's the point of the Holy Spirit? It will bring Israel into saving faith in Christ the Messiah. Last Wednesday night, I read to you in chapter 12, and I put it back on here, verse 9. For on that day, I will begin to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. So in that day, you can picture war, God fighting somehow in the war. And verse 10, and on that day, I will pour out my spirit of grace and prayer on the family of David and the people of Jerusalem. It's in chapter 12. It's in chapter 13. What? He's pouring something out on the dynasty of David and the people of Jerusalem. They will look on me whom they have pierced and mourn for him as for an only son. They will grieve bitterly for him who a firstborn son who has died. There's a day coming when God's going to just pour himself out on these people, on the dynasty of David. And it will be in the time of war. It will be specifically in Jerusalem. And it will be specifically on Israel, the people. Now, hold that thought, and if you want to understand this this water, this fountain, he calls it a fountain opened. Go to John 7, and I've got it next listed, and Jesus is at a festival, and let's take a Holy Spirit New Testament perspective and compare the two. Oh, in the Old Testament, it's a fountain, and he's pouring it out on the dynasty of David and the people of Jerusalem. In the New Testament, it says this, on the last day, the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and he shouted to the crowds, anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Now, what is, anybody see a correlation already? What's the fountain? It's water. Anybody thirsty? You want a drink? Come get a drink. You think he's talking about H2O? No. He's talking about what? The Holy Spirit. Anyone who believes in me can come and drink. Believing, you can get a drink. What drink? For the scriptures declare, rivers of living water will flow from his heart. Rivers, fountains, drinking, heart. 39. When he said living water, he, Jesus, was speaking of the Spirit who would be given to everyone believing in him, but the Spirit had not yet been given. He's asking them to come get a drink, but the Spirit had not yet been given because Jesus had not yet entered his glory. Now, with that in mind, do you remember when Jesus looks at his disciples, his apostles, and says, it is good for you that I leave. It's good that I leave. Why? Because when he leaves, the Spirit will come. And when he leaves, the Spirit won't just come on small numbers of people. When he leaves, the Spirit will be able to come like a flood, like a fountain. And it can spread all over people. Not one person or two persons or 12 persons, but 3,000 people. Right? Sin and impurity will be cleansed by this fountain. It'll be cleansed by faith in Christ when the Holy Spirit comes to Israel. Has it happened yet? No. As a nation, has Israel received the Messiah? No. As a nation, no. Are there Jews that have? Yes, of course there are. But as a nation, no. They're still waiting for a Messiah. The result of the Holy Spirit coming to Israel Israel will be justified and purified by faith in Christ the Messiah. The same thing that makes you and I right with God must happen to them. The same thing. Now, how it happens might be a little different application, but the same thing must happen. You and I have received the Holy Spirit. It didn't come like a fountain poured out on a day or on a moment or in some climactic event across the world. You and I individually in the church age received the fountain opening and the water came to us and we were made right with God through faith. We believed. We got a drink of this water. And because of that, we were made right with God through faith. There's a day coming when Israel will be made right with God through faith. How? Who's going to initiate the getting right with God part? Israel? No, they're not going to initiate it. You didn't initiate it either. He offered you water. Look at what Jesus says. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink. Who offered you a drink? He did. You didn't say, I'll have some of that water. Actually, you would run from that water. He offers you water. The result of the Holy Spirit coming, justification, purification by faith. In other words, what do those churchy words really mean? You're made right with God. Israel will then be declared righteous, and thus they are made right with God through faith, not the law. The law didn't work, couldn't make them right with God. Now, hold that thought, go to the book of Romans, because I want to make a point of this before we move on. In fact, it says the message is very close at hand. What message? The message that'll make you right with God. It's on your lips, it's in your hearts, and that message is the very message about faith that we preach. What makes you right with God? Faith. What do preachers preach? They better be preaching the message of faith. What is the message of faith? If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. What is it that makes you believe in your heart? What is it that makes you confess with your mouth? The Holy Spirit, the fountain opens. And until the fountain opens, you will never confess with your mouth. And until the fountain opens, you'll never believe in your heart. Jesus says, no one can come to the Son unless the Father draws him. How does he draw you? He draws you by the Holy Spirit through the Word of God. Verse 10 in Romans, he says, for it is by believing in your heart that you're made right with God. Believing in your heart makes you right with God. Which comes first, believing or the Holy Spirit? You don't know what to believe until the Holy Spirit comes. If you think believing in your heart gives you the Holy Spirit, then you think that you can initiate a relationship with God. You can't. The Holy Spirit comes and offers you a drink. At that moment, you have been given. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart as they did in the rebellion. Today, he has to do something to initiate it. The Holy Spirit's offered. The water's offered. The fountain's opened. He did that for you and I. He's going to do it one day, supernaturally, on a grand scale to Israel. There's a difference. It's a grand scale to Israel. It was a grand scale on the day of Pentecost, okay? That was a grand scale. It was in Jerusalem. There's a pattern. It happened on a grand scale that day. 3,000 people, what? Peter preached the word. The Holy Spirit brought the fountain. And people said, what must we do to be saved? Let me go back to verse 10. For it is by believing in your heart that you're made right with God. It's confessing with your mouth you're saved. As the scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. And notice the next thing. Jews and Gentiles are the same in this respect. What? Israel will need to confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord. Until now, as a nation, they have refused to do so. Israel has refused up to now to do the two things. It's believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth. Why? They're still waiting for a Messiah. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You know what? The Old Testament prophecies say there is a day that Israel will call upon the name of the Lord. When? When the fountain opens. Zechariah 13:2. Let's go to the next verse back in Zechariah. Now focuses on the focus changes after verse 1. Now we're going to focus on the land from fountain and people to land and people. Now, it's not just individuals or small group, but a broader group of people, including the land itself. On that day, says the Lord of Heaven's armies, I will erase idol worship throughout the land. He's going to do something broader than just Jerusalem. He's going to erase idol worship throughout the land so that even the names of the idols will be forgotten. That's interesting to me. What was that thing we used to worship? You don't remember, do you? I will remove from the land both the false prophets and the spirit of impurity that came with the false prophets. On that day, idolatry will be removed from the land. Let's focus a minute on what does that really mean, idolatry. I will remove all the substitutes from the land, all those who compete for the allegiance of the heart of man. Okay, so what preceded that? The fountain is opened. The dynasty of David receives the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit falls on Jerusalem, on the people. And suddenly, there's a heart-pounding anticipation that the one is going to come and fulfill the dynasty of David is about to appear. When that happens, do you think you'll look for a substitute? No. No substitutes. Why? Because Jesus is the original. He's not a duplicate. He's not a copy. He's the original. On that day, false prophets and spirit of impurity and demons will be removed from the land. I've often thought that it's a good thing that we don't see some things. There's a spiritual battle that's raging around us now. And if you had eyes, and if I had eyes to see the spiritual battle, I might not sleep tonight. Because the spiritual battle is there are demons that are raging around us, at war against us. Demons, demonic forces. You can't see them, I can't see them. You remember the story in the Old Testament, Elisha? I think it was Elisha. I always sometimes get him and Elijah mixed up. That they're surrounded, and they're surrounded in the city, and it looks like all is lost, and Elisha's servant is freaking out, having an anxiety attack. Why? Because he thinks, oh, they're going to kill us. It's just me and you. And Elisha has eyes that see what people can't see. And he prays to God and says, would you let this dude see what I'm seeing? Because I'm chilled out here on the couch. I kind of paraphrased that part a little bit. But so anyway, Elisha says that, and the servant opens up, and what does he see? He sees hordes of God's army surrounding them. Are there demons in the battle? Yes, yes, but there are more of us than there are them. I want you to picture that in Jerusalem, on that day, false prophets and the spirit of impurity. Spirit, what do you think that means? Spirit of impurity. Demonic realm. Let me say something else too. Not in the text. The Bible specifically says the closer we get to the coming of Christ, the more the demonic spirit will rise. And I read an article in the Catholic Church is greatly increasing exorcisms around the world. They actually do that, where they actually go in and have exorcisms of demonic possessions. It will increase as we approach. Even here, it says specifically the spirit of impurity will be removed from the land. God's going to do something that moves the evil spirits. You got to leave. When Jesus was in the flesh and he walked into, remember the pigs? You know, they cried out that the spirit, the demon says, don't throw us into the abyss. You have to leave when Jesus comes. You cannot occupy the same territory when Jesus comes. Jesus is preparing Jerusalem for his arrival, and the spirits of demons will have to leave And what's it announcing? The spirit of impurity will be removed from the land. This is the time of Jesus' physical coming to the earth. And God's preparing the land for his arrival. You're going to have to leave now. His glory will dwell in Jerusalem. And the Antichrist, who will be in power when he comes. You know that, don't you? The Antichrist will be in power when he arrives. It's very clear. Two pictures from the book of Daniel regarding this time of the end that Zechariah refers to. Now let's go, before I read Daniel, go back up to Zechariah 13:2 again. On that day, the Lord of heaven's armies will erase idol worship throughout the land so that even the names of idols will be forgotten. What are idols anyway? It's either nothing or it's demons. There's not another God out there, okay? It's the spirit of Satan. I'll remove from the land both the false prophets and the spirit of impurity. With that in mind, understand Daniel precedes. Daniel's about 586 B.C. Zechariah's about 520 B.C. So Daniel would have written this before the time of Zechariah. And here's what Daniel's prophecy says, Daniel 2:44. During the reign of those kings, whose kings? What kings? Gentile kings. Understand, Gentile kings. What's the spirit, what's the fountain going to come upon? The dynasty of David. Why? A Jewish king is about to take his seat. There'll be one more. His name's not Zedekiah either. During the reign of those kings, the Gentile kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed and will never be conquered. It will crush all these kingdoms into nothingness. What? Gentile kingdoms. And it will stand forever. That is the meaning of the rock cut out of the mountain, cut from the mountain, though not by human hands, that crushed the statue of iron, bronze, clay, silver, and gold. What do those things represent? They all represent the Gentile kingdoms of man. But a Jewish king is coming. If the head of gold, everybody listen, if the head of gold was the original of the Gentile kingdoms, Nebuchadnezzar, what was before him? Jewish kings. Who did Nebuchadnezzar depose? The dynasty of David. And then the head of gold, Babylon, the chest of silver, Medo-Persia, Alexander the Great. Right? See, the kingdoms of men. But preceding Nebuchadnezzar, there was a Jewish king in the dynasty of David. Nebuchadnezzar ended it. And now look at Daniel's prophecy. That is the meaning of the rock. Who's the rock? Who's the rock that makes them stumble, the stone that makes them fall? You know who he is. He's a Jewish king from the dynasty of David. That is the meaning of the rock cut from the mountain, though not by human hands. Is there a man that's going to put this Jewish king on the throne? No, not by human hands, no. His daddy is not of this world. Not by human hands, that crushed the pieces of statue, iron, bronze, clay, silver, gold. The great God was showing the king, Nebuchadnezzar, what will happen in the future. The dream is true and its meaning is what? What's that last word? Certain. The only question is, when's he going to do it? When will there be a Jewish king in Jerusalem who will destroy all the Gentile kingdoms of the world? He will destroy them. Do you understand that? He won't come sign a peace treaty. That's the Antichrist. He's going to destroy them. He will conquer them. He will crush them. In the midst of the tribulation, when will that happen? In the midst of the great tribulation, the Antichrist will set up an abomination that causes desolation or desecration in the Jerusalem temple, defiling the temple and defiling the land. Daniel 12:9. But he said, go now, Daniel. The angel's talking to Daniel. Go now, Daniel, for what I have said is kept secret and sealed until the time of the end. Many will be purified. Many will be cleansed and refined by these trials. Who are they who will be purified and refined by these trials? Go back up to Zechariah. What's happening in Zechariah chapter 13 at the end? He's preparing for the arrival of the Jewish king. And I'll remove from the land false prophets and spirits of impurity. And there's trouble all over the world when that happens. But he's purifying people. He's removing idolatry, removing false prophets as he prepares for the coming of the Messiah, the king. Many will be purified. Back down in Daniel 12:10. Many will be purified, cleansed, refined by these trials. But the wicked will continue in their wickedness, and none of them will understand. Only those who are wise will know what it means. From the time, listen carefully, from the time that the daily sacrifice is stopped. Well, let me tell you, you can't stop the daily sacrifices. What daily sacrifices? They'll be in the Jerusalem temple. You know, they don't do daily sacrifices in Israel right now. Do you know why? There's no temple. There will be. And from the time that the daily sacrifices are stopped, well, you can't stop them until you start them. From the time that they are stopped, and the sacrilegious object that causes desecration is set up, there will be 1,290 days. You know what that is? 3.5 years. You know what I think that means? It means that there will be an agreement. The book of Daniel says there will be an agreement signed between the Antichrist and Israel that will usher in the tribulation. Some point, the Jewish temple will be rebuilt, and at some point, they will restart animal sacrifices on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Notice what he says. From the time that the daily sacrifices are stopped, and the sacrilegious object that causes desecration, there will be 3.5 years. 3.5 years into the 7-year tribulation, which would mark what? The halfway point, the Antichrist will stand on the Jerusalem temple, prophesied by Daniel and quoted by Jesus himself. He will stand on the Jerusalem temple mount and proclaim to the world that he is God, the abomination that causes desolation. The wrath of God will come. 3.5 years. Why am I giving you Daniel? Because Zechariah 13:2 announces the events that precede what's going on in the tribulation in the time of Zechariah 13:1. You know what's about to happen in Zechariah 14. But you know what's going to precede it? The pouring out of the Holy Spirit and the coming of Christ will purify the people and the land of sin and impurity. Now, when that happens, false prophets, you got to go. Look at what he says, Zechariah 13:2. And on that day, says the Lord of heavens, I will erase idol worship through the land so that even the names of idols will be forgotten. I will remove from the land both the false prophets and the spirit of impurity that they came with them. If anyone continues to prophesy, here's what he's saying. If at that point, once my spirit is poured, once the fountain opens and pours on the dynasty of David and pours out in Jerusalem, if anyone continues to prophesy, his own father and mother will tell him you must die. Why? You'll understand in a moment. For you have prophesied lies in the name of the Lord. Will you need to prophesy when he is here? And as he prophesies, his own father and mother will stab him. Can I just say, if you feel like you want to prophesy in this scene, stop it. Because it says your mother and father would stab you. What is he trying to say? Well, stay with me. On that day, people will be ashamed to claim a prophetic gift. What is this whole prophesy? What is this whole announcing what's coming? People will be ashamed to proclaim a prophetic gift. No one will pretend to be a prophet by wearing prophet clothes. He will say, I'm no prophet. I'm a farmer. I'm not a prophet. You don't want to say you're a prophet. Why? Your parents will stab you. Why? I'm not a prophet. I'm a farmer. I began working in a farm as a boy. This Holy Spirit change, listen, this change in Israel will turn the people against their past sins, such as false prophets and tolerating false prophets. Why? Listen, the fountain is being opened on the dynasty of David. The fountain is going to pour out on Jerusalem. The fountain is not God light. The fountain is the presence of God's coming across the land. And if light starts coming across the land, darkness will have to leave. And if you try to hold on to the darkness when the light comes, you will be destroyed. Because light's coming. The Old Testament law was clear about the consequence of false prophets. Do you think God's ever really been happy with false prophets? Well, if you think it's weird what Zechariah 13 prophesies about false prophets before the coming of Christ, go back to the beginning. Go to Deuteronomy 13, 6. Suppose someone secretly entices you, okay? They don't do it out loud. They secretly entice you. Even your brother, your son, your daughter, your beloved wife, or your closest friend says, let's go worship other gods. That's what he's telling us here in Deuteronomy. Let's go. Secretly enticing. I don't want to say it out loud, right? Gods that neither you nor your ancestors have known. They might suggest that you worship the gods of people who live nearby, the Philistines or Molech, or, you know, think about when they moved into Canaan, or who come from the ends of the earth. But do not give in or listen. Have no pity. Do not spare or protect them. You must put them to death. So if somebody came up in Deuteronomy, in the time of Deuteronomy, under the Old Testament law, and someone whispers in your ear, let's go worship Molech. You got to die. Did they get jail? No, you got to die. What? Is that a little harsh? No, you got to die. Who's doing this? Moses? No, God. Any of y'all understand how God feels about idolatry? You're going to die. Listen to what he says. You must put them to death. Strike the first blow yourself. And then all the people must join in. Stone the guilty ones to death. Because they have tried to draw you away from the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of slavery. Then all Israel will hear about it and be afraid. No one will act so wickedly again. Now, if that's kind of how it was when Israel became Israel and moved into Canaan, what do you think it'll be like when Israel is Israel and they've moved back into Canaan, regathered from the four corners of the earth, and God's preparing the dynasty of David to sit on the throne? Idolatry is not going to make it. The mother and father of a false prophet will stab, and the interesting word is pierce, their child, if they prophesy in those future days. It's interesting that the word pierced is the same word that described what the false prophets did to Jesus on the cross, and now it'll totally be turned on the false prophets. So on the cross, the false prophets pierced Jesus. But the reality is in Zechariah 13, it'll be the other way around. The false prophets will be pierced, stabbed. They won't even wear what was considered to be prophet's clothing in those days. Did you catch that? Let me read it again, verse 4 and 5. On that day, people will be ashamed to claim the prophetic gift. No one will pretend to be a prophet by wearing prophet's clothes. I bet you nobody in here, well, I'm not going to say nobody, very few of you knew that prophets had a certain attire. No one will want to wear prophet's clothes. He'll say, I'm no prophet, I'm a farmer. I began working for a farmer as a boy. So what did prophet's clothes look like? I can give you a hint in Matthew 3, 4. I've already told you the last prophet of the Old Testament, John the Baptist, what did he wear? John's clothes were woven of coarse camel hair. He wore a leather belt around his waist and he ate, can you imagine his breath? Locust and wild honey. I like the honey part. And if I'm going to eat locust, I'd like to have some honey on them, now that I think about it. Do you remember, here's the point I want to make, because this is real time today. Have y'all seen, and I'm sensitive to this because we've had to deal with it in the church, teenagers cutting themselves. Most of us cannot comprehend it, but it's real. What you might not know is where it comes from. Do you remember when the false prophets of Baal get called into the showdown with Elijah on Mount Carmel? This was a common practice. What did they do? They cut themselves. Where does it come from? I had the privilege several years ago, and I'm going to read it to you. In 2010, actually it's been 5 years ago, I went to Israel, and I went to the Mount Carmel. And what really makes this an amazing scene is when you stand on Mount Carmel and you look out, you see the Valley of Armageddon. It's called the Valley of Megiddo. Napoleon is quoted to have said when he came there with his armies that you could gather all the armies of the world on this vast plain, and one day they will. And on top of Mount Carmel, there is a statue, huge, probably as tall as this building almost, of Elijah, a bronze-looking statue, and his foot is on the neck of the prophet of Baal. And his sword is drawn. It stands on top of Mount Carmel. An amazing scene. Not very politically correct, but I love it just the same. Okay? But in the showdown with the prophets of Baal, I'm contrasting this to Zechariah chapter 13 about what will happen if you try to prophesy in the days leading up to the coming of the Jewish king, Jesus. 1 Kings 18:27, Mount Carmel. About noontime, Elijah began mocking them, the prophets, the false prophets. "You'll have to shout louder," he scoffed, "for surely he is a god. Perhaps he's daydreaming or he's relieving himself." Ooh, I thought they didn't like that, I bet you. "Or maybe he's away on a trip or asleep and needs to be wakened, your god." So they shouted louder, and following their normal custom, I want you to notice something. These false prophets, following their normal custom, they cut themselves with knives and swords until the blood gushed out. Why are they cutting themselves? When Jesus is in the New Testament and he visits the man who lived in the tombs, what did he do to himself? He's cutting himself. Why? Anybody see something developing here? They raved all afternoon until the time of the evening sacrifices. There's still no sound, no reply, no response. But I want to focus not on the scene itself, but these false prophets are cutting themselves. This man who lived among the tombs is cutting himself. So we've got teenagers cutting themselves. Zechariah 13:6. "And if someone asks, then what about the wounds on your chest?" And if you, I should have read the verse before it. He says, "I'm not a prophet, I'm a farmer. I'm not a prophet, I'm a farmer. Then what about the wounds on your chest?" He said, "I was wounded at my friend's house." But you know what the wounds on his chest are? He's cutting himself. Why? Where's it coming from? Well, I think after this discussion tonight, you'll know where it's coming from. There are only two spirits on the earth, the Spirit of God and the spirit of Satan. There are only two powers at work. There's only two powers at work. There's the Spirit of God, and there's the spirit of the adversary of God. One will make you cut yourself. So if I look at the prophets of Baal, they're cutting themselves. I look at the man who living among the tombs. He's cutting himself. Kind of scary, isn't it? Truth has come. Zechariah 13, what's the scene? Truth has come, and thus false prophets will flee in fear of the real truth, the Messiah. The final section tonight deals with the scattering of the sheep and Israel's relationship with the Messiah. We're going to get a little deep, so hang on. Verse 7, "Awake, O sword. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, the man who is my partner." Listen carefully to the words. "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, the man who is my partner, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Strike down the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered, and I will turn against the lambs. 2/3 of the people in the land will be cut off and die, says the Lord, but 1/3 will be left in the land. I will bring that group through the fire and make them pure. I will refine them like silver and purify them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them and I will say, these are my people. And they will say, the Lord is our God. So let's kind of walk down through those few verses. Awake, O sword. Do you really want to wake the sword up? Think about it. The sword is a picture of death. The sword is a picture of judgment. And this scene is not about the second coming of Christ. This scene specifically is about his first coming. The Messiah will die a violent death, the cross. The true shepherd will be struck down and the sheep will be scattered. In fact, can you tell me right now how many of the sheep stood around the cross when the shepherd was dying a violent death? One. The sheep were scattered. Strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. Only John is recorded as being at the cross. And what did the shepherd say to John? Behold your mother. Mary, behold your son. In other words, John, will you take care of my mother? The other sheep have scattered. Now, Zechariah is 520 years before Jesus is born in Bethlehem. We've already seen what? We've already seen he's prophesied that he'll come on a donkey, on the foal of a donkey. We've already been prophesied that Judas will betray him for 30 pieces of silver, and those silver coins will be thrown into the temple and go to the potter's field. We've already seen the detail. Now you're seeing what? The shepherd will be brutally killed and the sheep will scatter. God calls the good, true shepherd, my shepherd. Now, go up and look at the wording. My son, my partner. At least as it translates in the NLT. When the sheep strike down the true shepherd. Who's striking down the shepherd? You might say, well, that was Rome. No, it was Rome carried out the deed, but who struck him down? The sheep. The sheep. Israel. Israel. When the sheep strike down the true shepherd, the Lord of heaven's armies will turn against the lambs. A scene of the cross and the times that follow the cross until the end of days. Listen, that will follow the cross until the end of days. The good shepherd was rejected and killed on the cross somewhere around, well, on our calendar would be 30 AD, somewhere around that time. A lot of different dating techniques to the early years. The sheep were scattered in the dispersion of 70 AD and the temple was trampled and destroyed. This scene also appears in the Garden of Gethsemane as Jesus is taken prisoner. What? Strike the shepherd. The sheep will scatter. And Jesus himself quotes the book of Zechariah. You want to know if Zechariah is real? Well, Jesus is quoting it. Matthew 26, on the way, Jesus told them, tonight all of you will desert me. For the scriptures say, I wonder where he found it, in Zechariah. God will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. Zechariah said it 520 years before Jesus got here, and then Jesus quotes Zechariah, which gives what? Validity to Zechariah as a prophet 500 years later. There's a very serious implication to the next detail. This is where we get deep, so hang on. Verse 8. 2/3 of the people in the land will be cut off and die, says the Lord, but 1/3 will be left in the land. Many believe I'd be one of those. This will be the fulfillment of the great tribulation when Israel will suffer tremendous persecution. In fact, let me say, most of Satan's attack in the tribulation focuses on Israel. Jesus himself announces this in Matthew 24, what we call the Olivet Discourse. 3.5 years into the 7-year tribulation, an event will occur prophesied by Daniel. Jesus brings it up in the Olivet Discourse. The day is coming when you'll see what Daniel the prophet spoke about. The sacrilegious object that causes desecration standing in the holy place. And then what, reader, pay attention. I didn't put that in there. That's Matthew's text. Then those in Judea must flee for the hills. Why would you run? A lot of people read this and they don't understand what's going on. If this is God coming, can you run from God? No, not likely. When the sacrilegious object, when Satan stands on, let me put it simple. When Satan stands on the Temple Mount and tells the world he's God, run. I'm going to tell you what he's saying. Run. If you're in Judea, run. Let me get specific. A person out on the deck of the roof must not go down to the house and pack. And I'll say, run. A person in the field must not return to get his coat. Why? Run. How terrible it'll be for pregnant women, for nursing mothers in those days. Why? Because you can't run. And pray that your flight will not be in winter on the Sabbath. For there will be greater anguish than in any time since the world began. It will never be so great again. Whew, that's heavy. In fact, unless the time of calamity is shortened, not a single person will survive. But it will be shortened. Praise God for his mercy. For the sake of God's chosen ones. I'm going to give you a hint. The 1/3. Then if anyone tells you, look, here's the Messiah, or there he is, don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will rise up and perform great signs and wonders so as to deceive, if possible, even God's chosen ones. See, I have warned you about this ahead of time. You won't be able to say you didn't know. Run. So if someone tells you, look, the Messiah is out in the desert, don't bother to go and look. Or look, he's hiding here. Don't believe it. For as lightning flashes in the east and shines to the west, so it will be when the Son of Man comes. Just as the gathering of vultures shows there's a carcass nearby, so these signs indicate that the end is near. Why did I read Matthew's Olivet Discourse? Go back up to Zechariah 13:8, right above it. 2/3 of the people in the land will be cut off and die, but 1/3 will be left in the land. And when you see the sacrilegious object that causes desolation, run. You want to be in the 1/3. Now go to Revelation chapter 12. Then I witnessed in heaven an event of great significance, and I saw a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon beneath her feet and a crown of 12 stars on her head. Who is she? She is Israel. How do you know? She's got 12. What is Israel? Who is Israel? Who is Israel? His name was Jacob. How many children did he have? 12. She was pregnant. Who? Israel. She cried out because of her labor pains and the agony of giving birth. Then I witnessed in heaven another significant event. I saw a large red dragon. Do I have to bring up who he is? I hope not. You're in the wrong class if I got to tell you who he is. He had 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his heads. His tail swept away 1/3 of the stars in the sky. Let me say, a lot of people believe, you're getting into territory over my pay grade in that area, but a lot of people believe this is direct reference of the demonic realm. The demonic realm that fell with Satan. 1/3 of the stars in the sky. Some people would put it in a different category. His tail swept away 1/3 of the stars in the sky. Is this a fall of demons, or is this a fall of other people? The problem with it being a fall of the 1/3 is the 1/3 is the ones that are saved in Zechariah, not the other way. I would lean more toward this as the fallen. His tail swept away 1/3 of the stars in the sky, and he threw them to the earth. Demons, followers of the rebellion. He stood in front of the woman, who's Satan, the red dragon. He stands in front of the woman. Satan stands in front of Israel. As she's about to give birth, ready to devour her baby as soon as it's born. Who? How? What? Mary is Jewish. She represents Israel. She's going to have a son. And the red dragon wants to devour the child when he is born. Can somebody tell me how? Do you remember what Herod did at the birth of Jesus? Kill all the babies. Did Herod come up with that idea? No. There are only two spirits. There's the spirit of God and there is the spirit of Satan. The spirit of Satan has put inside Herod's mind, kill the babies. The red dragon wants to kill the babies. Why? She, Israel, gave birth to a son who was to rule all nations with an iron rod. By the way, you'll find that reference in multiple applications. What do you think it means he'll rule with an iron rod or an iron scepter? Absolute authority. And her child was snatched away from the dragon, caught up to God and to his throne. Can you see them on the Mount of Olives east of Jerusalem after the death, burial, and the resurrections? And why do you stand here gazing at the clouds? Don't you know that the same Jesus who has departed will return in the same way that he left? He was snatched up into the heavens. Now listen, what'll happen next? And the woman fled into the wilderness. Now, I believe this is a future scene. And the woman fled into the wilderness where God had prepared a place to care for her for, coincidentally, 3.5 years. I believe that when he's telling in Olivet Discourse, run, this is the 1/3. What? Run. If 3.5 years is when the abomination that causes desolation. And he says, if you're on your house, don't go in the house. Don't get your coat. Run. Get out of the city. And then as a woman fled into the wilderness where God has prepared a place to care for her for 1,260 days, that's 3.5 years. Then there was war in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels. Is the dragon and his angels the 1/3 that his tail swept from the sky? Probably. And the dragon lost the battle, and he and his angels were forced out of heaven. This great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to the earth with all his angels. Then I heard a loud voice shouting across the heavens, "It is come at last, salvation and power in the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down to the earth, the one who accuses them before our God day and night. And they have defeated him by the blood of the Lamb. By their testimony, and they did not love their life so much they were afraid to die." By the way, I think those three things would be really good for you to put on your checklist every single day. That I have the blood of the Lamb, and I have a testimony about what that Lamb did for me, in me, through me, around me. And I do not love this life so much that I would be afraid to die for his name. Because you know what? How did they defeat this red dragon? You won't say you didn't know how, because that's how you do it. The blood of the Lamb, the word of your testimony, and you do not love your life so much you'd be afraid to die. Verse 12, "Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who live in the heavens rejoice, but terror," look at the word, nobody likes that word, "will come on the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you and he's messed up mad." That's not really in there. I did that. Why? Why is he messed up mad? Because he's out of time. When the dragon realized that he had been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman that had given birth to the male child. Ultimately, the battle will come against Satan trying to devour Israel. You ever wonder why Haman wanted to kill all the Jews, why Hitler wants to kill all the Jews, why Iran wants to kill all the Jews? Everybody wants to kill the Jews. Somebody leave the Jews alone. Why? He wants to devour them. Verse 13 again. When the dragon realized he's been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. If I could stop the Jews, I can stop the end, right? Wrong. You won't stop it. But she was given two wings like that of a great eagle, so she could fly to the place prepared in the wilderness. There she would be cared for and protected from the dragon for, everybody listen, time, times, and half a time. I can tell you what I think that means. I think that's 3.5 years. Where do you get 3.5 years out of there? Time, times, and half a time. If time is a year, if time, times, and a half a time, if time equals a year, what does that equation equal? Time, one, times, two, and a half, 3.5. Somebody says, you're stretching. Well, I'd be stretching if that's the only place in the Bible that said that. But I'm not stretching when it says it over and over and over again and even lists 1,260 days. Not such a stretch. Then the dragon tried to drown the woman with a flood. By the way, I think verse 14 and 15 are literal events that will occur as Satan tries to destroy Israel in the last 3.5 years of the Great Tribulation, in which 2/3 will die, 1/3 will remain. He will kill many of them. Then the dragon tried to drown the woman with the flood of water that flowed from his mouth, but the earth helped her by opening its mouth and swallowing the river that gushed out from the mouth of the dragon. And the dragon was angry at the woman and declared war against the rest of her children and all who keep God's commandments and maintain their testimony for Jesus. You want to get along with the devil? Give up your testimony for Jesus. But then you got another problem. His name is God. Is it possible that 2/3 of the Jews alive when the Great Tribulation began will not survive it? There is a promise of God that 1/3 will survive it. He calls them the remnant. In Romans 9:27, it says, and concerning Israel, Isaiah the prophet cried out, though the people of Israel are as numerous as the sands of the seashore, only a remnant will be saved, for the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth quickly and with finality. Zechariah 8:11, we'll back up a few chapters in Zechariah. But now I will not treat the remnant of my people as I treated them before, says the Lord of heaven's armies, for I am planting seeds of peace and prosperity among you. The grapevines will be heavy with fruit. The earth will produce its crops. The heavens will release the dew. Once more, I will cause the remnant in Judah and Israel to inherit these blessings. Zechariah 13:9. 2/3 of the people in the land will be cut off and die, says the Lord, but 1/3 will be left in the land. I will bring that group through the fire. This is the very end. I will bring that group through the fire and make them pure. I will refine them like silver and purify them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say, these are my people, and they will say that the Lord, he is our God. Now, one bit of correlation of end time prophecy to today's news. I've been doing that for the last several weeks. Did you know that France has the third largest Jewish population in the world behind Israel and the United States? And if Satan wants to devour the children of the woman, where would he go? Here's an article that I clipped out from November 23rd. That'd be Monday. Young French Jews bolt for Israel. 127% increase since 2014. I'm just going to read part of it. Birthright Israel, the charity founded in 1999 to bring young Jews on trips to Israel, from France, can I say that, has witnessed an unprecedented increase in participation among French citizens over the past 2 years. The Observer, that's a news organization, has learned that 2,500 French Jews will have visited Israel as part of the program this year, more than double the 1,100 who went last year, and a stunning 2,400% increase over the 98 who visited its programs in 2013. The gains come among a string of high-profile attacks by radical Islamists in France, many targeting Jewish institutions. Now, pause for a moment. God has promised over and 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 over again that He's going to regather the people of Israel from the four corners of the earth. How? Do they all know that God's doing it, or are they just doing it because, man, this is not getting really safe to live in this neighborhood? They're moving home. In March 2012, three linked shootings in those two places targeted French military personnel as well as four people at the Ozar HaTorah Jewish Day School. I'm not going to read all that. I'm going to tell you what it says. Every one of the French outbreaks of terrorism by ISIS and other terrorist Muslim organizations have had a Jewish root. The hostages, the kosher market, a year ago when everybody came and marched through France in solidarity, Benjamin Netanyahu was there. You know where they killed those people that went to a kosher market? That's a Jewish market. Why did they go to a Jewish market? And this, I can't never think of the name, the Bataclan Theater, just a few weeks ago that all those people were killed. Do you know that's a Jewish-owned facility, the Bataclan? Coincidence? And in the middle of all of that, what? All these people are now fleeing. I read today in the newspaper that, and I know you've heard the uproar about all these Syrian refugees that are wanting to come into all the different countries of the world. I read today that the number of Muslim refugees coming to the United States, that number in itself, planned over the next few years, is a larger number of people than live in the Washington, D.C., more than 600,000 people. On top of all that, the last paragraph and then I'll stop. On top of French Jews being targeted and many moving back to Israel, just this week, Turkey shoots down a Russian fighter jet near the Syrian border on Tuesday. I'm going to tell you, world wars have begun with far less than that event. And I heard today that Russia has moved its military arsenal off the coast of Turkey. Maranatha, Hosanna, Hallelujah, Amen. Let's pray. Father, we believe you. We are a generation watching the fulfillment of your prophecy in our day. And I know, Lord, you even said it in your word, many have longed to see the things that we now see, but they did not. And we are. So, Lord, give us eyes that clearly understand. And then use us, Lord, to proclaim this truth of the soon return of Christ. First, make us ready, and then put us in the business of making other people ready for the glory of your own name and for the souls of man. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Happy Thanksgiving to everybody.